Yes, welcome to the Biz Communication Show. I'm your host, Bill Lampton, the Biz Communication Guy. Welcoming you once again to a lively conversation with a business communication professional so that you and I can learn tips and strategies that will boost our business. Today's guest is Gina Schreck from the Denver, Colorado metropolitan area. She's a return guest. Delighted to have her again. She's the president of Social KNX, and KNX does not stand for Kleenex. Social KNX stands for Social Connects. She says of it, we are a social media marketing firm helping organizations use social media tools to connect with their communities and build business. And here's a vital news flash. Gina was recently named a global guru among the world's top 30 internet marketing professionals for 2021. That's very exciting. And here's a part of the award citation. Gina doesn't just speak about something she read on a blog post or in a book. She has run a successful marketing agency for 24 years, studied new tech trends, and incorporates them into her two businesses, so she understands how to use these tools to build business. She will share best practice ideas and practical information that people can apply immediately, and then she makes it fun along the way. I can tell you that from my previous interview with her. She's the author of Social Media Doesn't Work Unless You Do. It's a wonderful book, which any of us who want to improve our social media performance, this book is for you. I encourage you to go to Amazon, look at my review of it. It's a video review and a text review. I highly recommend it for you. As a keynote speaker for decades, she's also past president of the Colorado chapter of the National Speakers Association. And so it's a true delight to welcome Gina. Gina, hello.
Thank you so much. Hello.
Good to have you with us.
Yes, it's great to be back.
Okay. Among the many topics that we could discuss, we're limited to a few today, and I'd like to start off with this one because I've seen your comments about it. Many of us, Gina, have the temptation to look at all the social media and think that as we look at our workday, well, I should spend 1 hour on this one and 1 hour on this one and 1 hour on this one. Facebook, my Facebook business page, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, and you could name 15 more. That's a strategy which we almost think, I've got to be everywhere. But what's your advice about that? You're sort of a contrarian. So tell us what's your advice about that.
And I would say it become more so lately because Clubhouse was one of the new ones that came up. Oh, now it's been around for a while, but Clubhouse, I'm hearing that people are on Clubhouse for hours. And I'm talking like 10 hours of their day is on Clubhouse. Now, if you've got a strategy and that is your business that you're able to make money being on there for 10 hours, more power to you. But most of us have things to do during the day and run a business. And so we need to look at social media platforms and say, which platforms are my customers on? And then how can I maximize my time and be on there the shortest amount of time? Because I have actually two co-working spaces plus a digital marketing agency. And we do the marketing. And I would say on our co-working spaces, we probably spend maybe 15 minutes a day. Depend if we have an event coming up, we might spend, my daughter will do a bunch of reels and things on Instagram. Maybe she'll spend 30 minutes of a day getting on there and really kind of being active. But you need to pick the audiences and the platforms that make sense for you. For the co-working spaces, we're not on LinkedIn. We're not on Clubhouse. We're on Instagram and Facebook, because those make sense for us. And so in the morning, get on there and reply to people. And if you have your phone with you, do that, you know, in those slivers of time when you're waiting in an appointment somewhere, get on and reply to people. I just don't think, I think people get confused over being super active and running a business that makes money. So my goal is always, let's run a business that makes money and let's use social media to connect to those audiences.
I think one of the points you're making there is if somebody has a lot of spare time and they just want to be on the social media for a hobby, you can be on all of them you want. But if you want to make a strong impact, so much so that you really monetize your presence, and you do it from a business standpoint, then it's impossible for one person to be on all of those. So I like your, it's okay to be familiar with all of those, maybe dabble a little bit here and there, maybe have a presence on several, but truly select one that fits you, that fits your service, that fits your product, and that fits your customers. Would that sum it up pretty well?
Absolutely. And again, there are a few people that somehow are, they're like you can go on Clubhouse and you can monetize. People can pay you and you're delivering content during that hour or 2 hours or 3 hours. So there are a few people, but most people in business, that's not describing them. Most people in business feel like, oh, I'm supposed to be everywhere because all these social media people are everywhere and they're on there all day. Not the case.
You mentioned Clubhouse. That was something that I wanted to ask you about. It's been around now a little over a year. There's several million people using it. I am on there once a week. I know some people are on there 5 and 6 times a week. And I have heard, as you probably have, of some people who will host a room for a Clubhouse room for 3, 4, and I've even heard 10 hours. And the question is, what do you really get out of that? So those of us who have heard of Clubhouse are those of us who are fairly new to it. I guess I've had a room on there for 7 or 8 weeks. What would be your advice to us about Clubhouse from what you know of it so far?
I love podcasts. I probably listen to 4 or 5 podcasts before I even get to work. From the time I get up, I'm getting ready in the morning, I'm listening to podcasts. So I love audio learning. So I like the idea of Clubhouse to get in and learn something. There are a lot of them where you're not learning a whole lot. There's a lot of them I've popped into rooms and it's, you know, they're not for me. So I do tune in and I get pinged a lot from co-working groups that are saying, hey, there's a great discussion on furniture design and layout in a co-working space. And I think, okay, that could be interesting for me to jump in and listen. And then they'll ask me to come up on the stage in Clubhouse to share how we designed. One of our spaces is really unique. And so I'll get on there and I'll share. That is not helping my business grow because that audience is probably not going to ever spend a dollar here. And I've been in social media groups where people ask me to come up and share and talk about, you know, different aspects of social media. Again, I'm not there trying to make money. I am there as an expert. So I look at that and say, it is an opportunity to become an influencer or a thought leader or whatever the word you want to say. I always say an authority. You're an authority in your field because you're sharing your knowledge, but I don't see a whole lot of people using it to monetize. So it depends on your business model. I like it just for learning and just like early Twitter. I love Twitter in the early days because we were on there sharing information and learning together. And that's still to me a great use of social media.
Do you host a room yourself on Clubhouse?
I just don't have time. I mean, right now I'm looking at a third location for a third co-working space. Right now I have so much going on that I just don't. I usually listen while I'm driving, so like a podcast, and I just have not had time to host. But not to say that that's not a great use of, if you can build an audience and then you can promote other things that you're doing. And again, to me, one of the uses of Clubhouse, like any social platform, if you are being seen as a resource, the go-to person for specific industry news, then that does build your authority in that space. And the more you can learn and share, the more people go to you for answers in that space.
My own experience with it, just to chime in, is that I have met some very prominent leaders that I would not have met otherwise. And in fact, on my biz communication show, I have interviewed three guests that I would not have known otherwise. So there's a possibility and even a likelihood that you will connect with some people that you would not have connected with otherwise. And so far, that to me is the value. And then also I'm teaming. I have two people who host the room with me, and I'm teaming with two people that I had not teamed with before. So those are a couple of advantages right there. Switching topics, Gina, and knowing you and having interviewed you before and being familiar with your social media posts themselves, I know that you are a person of humor. You're a fun person and you enjoy that. And you want your audiences, when you're a keynote speaker, to enjoy humor. You want your social media people to enjoy it. One of the points I think you could help us with, though, on our social media postings, what precautions would you give us about humor? Because it can be a wonderful tool for us, and at the same time, it could be a two-edged dagger. What's your advice you'd give us?
Yeah, and it's interesting because whether it's humor or being edgy, I always say, and we work with our clients a lot on this, of quit creating oatmeal content. Too much content out there is so bland. It's so ordinary. It's so overdone that no one cares anymore about what you're saying because it's too, I call it oatmeal. And so humor can add a little spice. And sometimes it doesn't have to be humor. Sometimes it can be your opinion. And I think in social media, we need to be more opinionated, but we also have to be a nice person. So I think first you have to start with a nice person who has values and isn't going to use humor to hurt anyone, because that can be done with sarcasm. That can be done with just statements, or it can be done with humor, disguised as humor. If you're a nice person, you typically don't have to worry about that. You're going to use humor in a natural way, but I do think it's important to stand out with your content because so many people create content that is just boring. And they wonder why their audience isn't growing. It's like, well, because you're boring. Your content is boring. Try taking a stand in your industry or on your topic. Say something that is so different that people say, okay, I really agree with that, or I totally disagree with that. It's okay to have that divide because you're gonna build the audience, a stronger audience. And again, if you're a nice person, because I've said all this, I'm like, I know people who have done this and they're mean. They're mean-spirited, they're using humor in a mean way to put others down. I say use humor to be kind of like the Jerry Seinfeld, like state the obvious in a way that you are viewing it. And I think that's the best kind of humor. I'm just a prude in this sense. I never cuss. I hate that everybody calls everybody a bad ass, or, you know, they're using language to these days that I feel like you don't have to do. And I feel like with humor, it's the same thing. You can use clean humor and state the obvious and you could be very funny, you could be humorous, and your content will stand out.
Those are excellent guidelines, Gina. And something I would add to that is, and we've said this before on the Biz Communication Show, that we always have to remember when we're dealing with social media, that what you say in cold print can be interpreted so many ways, because we don't have the advantage that we have face to face. If we say something with a bit of sarcasm and we're together and we smile and we pat each other on the back and we have a laugh about it, that's one thing. But if you say something with a little biting sarcasm and they don't see the wink or the smile, it can be vastly misinterpreted, can it?
Right. Well, and I make a comment a lot. I always say, okay, everyone, it's time to update your headshots. When I meet someone for the first time, I should not be shocked that you have aged. Like your photos, some people's photos look like they were taken glamour shots in the 90s, and it's time to update those. Now, that's a funny statement. That's a cutting statement if you're the person who has not updated your headshot in 20 years. But it's not picking a person out and saying it to that person. So I also think there's a difference in being edgy or funny and stating the obvious without singling out a person.
I sometimes see people's business cards and I wonder if that's their high school photo.
Or if it's a child. I was like, oh, I met your mom somewhere. When I see you in person, oh, I have the card of your daughter.
Right.
You.
Gina, we have time for one more question. In reading so much of your material, as I often do and benefit from so much, I came across this phrase. You've given this bit of advice. You say, stop collecting and start connecting. Explain that for us, please.
Well, and I really think it goes to that whole thing of we're on social media. Like, I mean, I've been in sales all my life. I've started in sales and it was about building relationships. And I think social media came on the scene and people got caught up in, I just want to connect with everybody. I just want to go on Clubhouse and I want to just connect and follow everybody. Instead of saying, I really want to connect with them. I want to get to know them. I want to listen to their content and then I want to give some sort of feedback that says, I love what you just shared. Thank you for that. That was helpful. That's connecting with someone versus collecting numbers and collecting people. And I really, to be honest, got burned out on Twitter because I just felt like Twitter, I just would see every day hundreds of people following me that had no idea. And then they would ask me in a DM, tell me about what you do. Like, why don't you tell me what I do? You're the one that connected with me. On LinkedIn, I get that. To me, those are people who are collecting numbers instead of making a connection. And on LinkedIn, instead of just connecting and collecting people, connect and send a message and get to know them. Read their bio before you send a message asking them what they do. I think we get caught up because we're so busy and there's so many social media platforms. We need to slow down and get one-on-one with people. And you're so good at that, of really getting to know people and taking the time to compliment somebody, you know, use those skills that we did in the old days of sales and apply those to social media.
Thank you for that compliment. You remind me of a time I was at a Chamber of Commerce business after hours. And I'll never forget this. There was one guy there who had I think it was a paint company. And he must have brought with him 75 business cards. He walked around, he handed everyone their business card and said, when you want painting done, I'm the guy. He didn't ask them about their business. He didn't have any conversations. I'm sure he thought he had scored well because he'd handed out so many cards. And I can guarantee you, Gina, the next day he was sitting by the phone. He didn't want to leave the phone. He was sure he was going to get a lot of phone calls, but he collected, but he did not connect. That's an excellent example right there.
Yeah, that's true. We still see that. We go to events and people are just, you know, tell me about what you do so I can tell, so that I don't have to listen to what your answer is. I just want you to start talking so I can figure out how to put a spin and tell you how you can work with me and pay me money. I still see that today.
And I'm looking over your shoulder so I can find the next person I want to talk with.
Yeah, exactly. Oh yeah. There's somebody more interesting. Yeah.
Gina, you're a wonderful resource. And I certainly know that people who have heard our podcast and watched us on the YouTube video, I know they'll want to get in touch with you. So please give us your contact information.
Yeah, you can find me. I mean, I always tell people on my business card on the back, it just says Google me, because my name is spelled uniquely enough that there's not many Gina Schrecks. You can Google Gina Schreck and you can connect with me on any social platform. I am on all of them, but typically LinkedIn, or you can go to our website, socialknx.com. And if you're ever in Denver metro area, stop by one of our co-working spaces. I'd love to invite you for coffee and get to know you and connect better.
I'm looking forward to the time when I'm going to be in the Denver area and I can take you up on that.
Yes.
So far we've connected on the internet, which is, it's great. We wouldn't have connected otherwise, but one day I'd love that opportunity to be in beautiful Denver, Colorado area, and what a conversation we could have, Gina.
It would be wonderful. I look forward to it.
And now that you've given your contact information, I'll give mine, Bill Lampton, the biz communication guy. So logically, my website is bizcommunicationguide.com. Invite you to go there, check my services for corporations and leaders. Give me a call and let's discuss your communication problems and we'll find solutions to them. Gina, any closing comment, please?
I'm going to leave you with one that I say all the time when it comes to social media, my three rules. Be interesting, be helpful, or be quiet.
That is great. Thank you. Thanks again to Gina Schreck for being with us. Thanks for those of you who were with us on YouTube and those on the podcast. Be with us again next week for another highly informative and interesting version of the Biz Communication Show. I'm your host, Bill Lampton, the Biz Communication Guy.